A Manual of Khshnoom, the Zoroastrian Occult Knowledge. By Phiroz Nasarvanji Tavaria. Chapter 13. Continues 3rd. Sunjana Dinkar Chapter 1. When Ormazd had produced the material environment of Zarathustra, the glory which was at the time near Ormazd, fled first unto the Aries, thence to the endless tides, zodiac, thence to the sun, thence to the moon, thence to the stars, and thence to dot the fire which was in the house of Zoish. From that fire it fled on, unto the wife of Frahim Ravana Zoish, father of prophet's mother, when that maiden was born who became the mother of Zarathustra, Sunjanas. Translation Vol 13 of Dinkard. It may be noted that the above description refers to the nature's process of purification through the above light, of the womb of the prophet's mother of Druhi-Ebuji, menstrual flow, to ensure immunition from material desires, from that glory that light escaped simultaneously into the earth and into the sky, then its flight became apparent at a distance, so that it was said by the people in the suburb of Fruktrabnun Zoish that the light burns through self-combustion, that is, it needed no fuel. Ibid. The demons, on account of their discomfiture by that glory in causing harm to that maiden, brought on that country dire winter, all kinds of pestilence and other tyrannical enemies, and they impressed on the minds of the people of the country that such a calamity had come to the country owing to the witchcraft of this girl, so that the people of the land awfully quarreled with the parents about the sorcery of the girl which was causing conflict, and about removing her out of that country. The father of the girl remonstrated with the people with manifold reason about the unjust allegation of witchcraft against the girl, that when that girl was born in my house, her entire halo emanated from behind her person, as the apparent light of a fire, that is, from the whole of her person superior light set forth in the dark night when this girl was seated in the innermost part of the house where there was no fire, or light, in the house where a large fire was burning, and if the girl was seated there, the burning became more dazzling owing to the light emanating from her body. A wizard was never known who was so glorious. Ibid. But owing to the instigation of the demons and the disbelievers who belonged to the country, the inhabitants were not satisfied, so the father ordered the girl to go to Padaradaraspo, the father of the family that lived in the country of the Spitamas, in the town situated on the Fiver Arag, and the girl assented to her father's order that mischief of the demons was caused with an evil design for removing the girl from her house, but God gloriously made it the cause for the father's sending of the girl to the house of Padaradaraspo, the father of Purushaspo, for her marriage with Purushaspo, the father of Zarathustra. Here she occupied the highest place in the country of the Spitamas, and she was inspired that her duty was to act according to her father's order. Then she performed religious ablution and proceeded to Padaradaraspo's village. At that stage the glory came to Purushaspo, the son of Padaradaraspo. Ibid. The creator Ormazd passed on the Fravahar of Zarathustra to the parents of Zarathustra through Aham, Hauma, plant, through miracle-producing tillage. Ibid. With regard to the necessity of the advent of Zarathustra on this earth, we are told that when this material world and mankind first came into existence, human beings for countless ages led holy life. Hence there was no need of Zarathustra to descend on the earth to teach mankind the antidemoniacal laws, i.e., the laws of purity. But this necessity arose subsequently when inferior souls descended on the earth and Satan succeeded in his guiles. All the above period of countless ages is designated by years. The technical exposition of these years is given under supplement number, and hence it is not necessary to repeat the same here. So it was at this stage that the Amishaspens formed together the material of Zarathustra, and they seated his Fravahar, spiritual essence, within. At that time Zarathustra appeared to the archangels as having a body like their own, Hamkarpa. This means that the prophet was not like worldly human beings subject to family life, but his body was lustrous like that of Amishaspens, Ibid. Then Ormazd discussed with Amishaspens about the achievement of perfect purity and spiritual wisdom and of good aura by the prophet's mother. He further discussed that since Zarathustra has a like body as of Amishaspens, he would be invisible on the earth, and hence it is necessary to invest him with Asnavira powers, i.e. powers to enable him to assume material body at will. For this purpose steps were taken to render both father and mother of Zarathustra purity perfect. Ham, Hauma, the Fravahar of Zarathustra is stated to have been conveyed into the stem of Ham, Hauma, by the Amishaspens because Ham possesses the characteristic of being constantly attracted to the worship of Ahu, the unamable absolute one in oneness. Ham is of three categories: A. Ham angel who proceeds from Ahu and is reattracted to Ahu; B. Ham, who, in Yasna, approaches Zarathustra and whom Zarathustra addresses as Nara, is the lustrous body, Kirp, of the angel Ham; and C. Ham in visible form is the plant, mentioned, which can grow only in the soil free from infestation of Ahriman, Satan. Besides, Ham represents the knowledge of Ahu. Ham is the medium of imparting immortality. Hence it is referred to in Yasna as Haumodura Asho Lit, repeller of death, by burning up the soul's evilakti, vd. Such being the characteristics of Ham, the Amishaspens modeled together a stem of horn of the height of a man, beautiful, of a superior color and juicy, where fresh and into that stem was conveyed by them the Fravahar of Zarathustra from the endless light, heaven of zodiac, to the village of Purushaspo, and it was produced there with a Snavira, lit, meaning innate intelligence. Asnavira indicates possession of the characteristics of an angel and capability of appearing at will in material form, as stated above. In paragraphs the language is highly enigmatical, as also stated in the beginning, about which, language, Professor Jackson rightly observes in footnote, much of all this, it is true, has a mythical ring or an allegorical note. With a view to elucidate these passages we reproduce Dastur Darab Sunjana's translation followed first by footnotes and then, by elucidations. And when years of the worldly existence of that blemish giver, Ahar man, remained, then they, Vohumano and Ashavishto, together arrayed themselves in their preeminence, transformed themselves into embodied existences, and came forth there where two birds were seated longing for progeny, since there, offspring in the nest had been devoured by Setpents 7 years before. While they were, in that meditation of theirs, Vohumano and Ashavishto came up, to them, and those birds consulted them thus, "Our salutations, to you, we wish to have that Hauma." There, the archangels, array with their preeminence in such a manner, and there, the birds, longing for the Hauma, are, a twofold wonder, from them he who was the male, bird, seized, or snatched off, the Hauma with both his legs, and, that one who was next carried away the Hauma, and it was set by them there on that tree above in, their, nest and they deposited it above, the place, the serpents so that the latter might pass of. Up to that nest which, was, of the progeny of the birds the Fravashi of Zarathustra proceeded, and hence also, the serpents in that tree directly rushed on at the demons, as if, that Fravahar of Zarathustra had smitten them on the jaws and the serpents fell down and died and hence also they are even now full of blood as to, their, seed, and that is necessary for such a species. That, Hauma, was engrafted with that tree, and on the top of the tree, or the engrafting of the Hauma with that tree, was, on its summit, there where were, located, the nests of the birds, it grew evergreen and golden colored. Footnotes to Nesti, the evanescent world there, space, including the known material two birds world progeny Jish Tashin, Yasna, and Jish offspring, Irva, the former regarded as the male bird called Amrug, Yash Nest, and the latter, the female bird called Shamrug, Ibid. As explained already several times, Jish does not mean ox, but the sub-angelic potentiality blissful like the ox or cow kind. Jish Tashin is stationed on Yuperi Dakyu, Yasht, the fourth region in the space, which is nature's laboratory of the four subtle elements, each getting electric circlings making in all from the permutations and combinations of which is formed Kirp, the internal invisible body form comprising plex uses from which the material body is developed. Souls to turn from vice to virtue. Space or material world. Engrossed in wickedness resulting in. Devoured by being subjected to the rounds of serpents death and birth between the sky and earth, Thwasha Kadida, vd 7 years. Before, according to Zoroastrian numerology, indicates sway either of good or Hauma evil forces. Here reference is to the evil carried away the preceding evil period of rank. Tree materialism under the influence of Nest Mars during the sway of that planet. Serpents in the heavens. Latter, serpents, blissfulness by the advent of might pass off Zarathustra and his faith resulting in destruction of the demons and fell down their nefarious activities and died. Imbibed or absorbed the blissful blood currents of Ashachitra, Vahachitra, whereby those elements evergreen and gradually became subtle. Golden-colored Geti, the material world. Nisti space, here. Evil propensities. Material world was rife with evils from demons and their followers, resulting in humanity subjected to rebirths. Devilry be subjugated. Began to die out. The demoniacal propensities, though reduced to embryonic state, still possess the destructive characteristic awaiting their time to grow. Hauma, possessing alchemizing power of turning evil into good, which is the characteristic of the Zoroastrian faith. Elucidations. When years of the above mentioned years of the worldly existence of Ahriman remained, the Amishaspens descended to the mortal worlds of the space and the material world. Here Jishtashan and Jishurva were seated, longing for souls to turn from vice to virtue, since mankind in the material world had been engrossed in wickedness to an abnormal degree. Hence they were subject to repetitions of death and birth during the preceding evil period of rank. Materialism under the influence of Mars during the sway of the intercycle of that planet in the heavens. While they, Jishtashan and Jishurva, were in that meditation, Biman and Ardibiasht came up to them, and the two Jish welcomed them and wished to have that hum which could terminate the sway of the demons and spread prosperity. Jishtashan grabbed the hum, i.e., the subtle elements or grades located on Yuparidakyu and from which are formed Kirps, the invisible body forms from which material bodies are developed, and Jishurva carried that hum, i.e., those blissful effects to the material world so that the evil effects, serpents, may be undone. With the inception of the Fravashi of Zarathustra, i.e. with the spread of the Mazdeyasni law of enfoldment of spirit into matter, the force of the evil propensities of the demons was broken and reduced to its embryonic state, though only bidding its time to develop. With the engrafting of Ham on the earth, which, Ham, bore the Farohar of Zarathustra, i.e., with the advent of the Jarthashti Mazdeyasni religion and the effects of Reformation, which were concomitant with the Farohar of Zarathustra, the evil effects began to disappear. When Purushaspo was wedded to Dogdobaman and Ardibiasht together came up to the grazing ground for the cattle of the Spitamas, and they drew their attention to the hum brought by them. Here the word cattle refers to the individuals possessing goodness, and grazing ground, to Mt. Albarts, which engenders goodness, to which the blissful currents of Ashachitra, Vahachitra flowed and turned the then Iran into a veritable paradise. Here there was a spot where stood Purushaspo's house. That spot is said to be in Derei Zabar, and Derei Zabar is said to be in Iran Vej, Aryanavayajia, V.D. Iran Vej was motherland of all people of righteous thought. This Iran Vej was in Thrishva in the Arctic region, at the top of which was Har Berez, the Mount Albarts. Here flowed from the immortal worlds the currents, depicted as flowing of river Derei, bearing the blissful seeds of Ashachitra and Vahachitra. Iran Vej had two extremities, one to the east, and the other to the west. Towards the west was a city called Rei. In this city was Derei Zabar, where there was a talismanic place which was consecrated, where lived Purushaspo. Here flowed holy currents from immortal worlds. It was in the fortune of Purushaspo to bring down those currents to the town of Rei. Exposition of crossing the waters of the river Daitya. A holy Athravan, priest, is supposed to possess different spiritual powers. Lbarushaspo possessed all these powers in entirety, and so he could listen to the divine music. By virtue of the possession of those powers, he knew how to perform the holy ceremony. Thus to take which particular type of posture, how to meditate, what pitch to adopt in incantation, how to begin the voice, so that the breath may also be softened whereby it may be possible to listen to the divine music of Ahunavar. All these holy practices are expressed as crossing the waters of the river Daitya. When a person passes 6 or 7 breaths per minute, his life energy, etc., become softened. In such a condition the two nostrils through which a person inhales and exhales assume certain motion. See, these two are expressed as the rivers Ranghu and Danghu in Avesta. Ranghu, Yasht, was on the west of Iranvej and Danghu or Daiti on the east. The names of these rivers are taken from the names of the plex uses of Iranvej soil. Ceremony for attracting spiritual essences on earth. When the spiritual essences Farohar, Bayadang, i.e., divine wisdom, soul, and subtle body of Zarathustra were to descend on the earth, Purushaspo donned his sudra and tied the kusti and performed the holy ceremony for attracting down the current of Hauma which contained the above essences. Thus by performance of the ceremony those essences were attracted to it on the earth. At that time the breaths of Purushaspo and Dugdab were attuned with the divine music of Ahunavar. When Ahura Mazda had produced the material of Zarathustra, his physical essence fled from the neighborhood of Ahura Mazda to that material, thence to Khordad and Amurdad, by the power of which Zarathustra could assume physical body on the earth or rarefy it at will. From thence, it fled to holy clouds, Huavra, and thence to the earth as rainwater and caused the plants to flourish. The essence of Zarathustra's body came from that water to those plants. In Par 6 white cows of yellow ears are mentioned. Yellow indicates possessing the development of Ray, divine self-intelligence. They belonged to Purushaspo whose sublime cerebral plex uses were enlightened, in the case of ordinary human beings they are in darkness. These cows possessed particles of the same soul as of Purushaspo and their Ray, self-intelligence, being elevated they were able to recognize the parent soul in Purushaspo. Dugdab milked those two cows which were not impregnated and gave that milk bearing Zarathustra's essence of body, to Purushaspo for mixing it with Hauma. When the Hauma and the milk were mingled together Purushaspo and Dugdab immediately drank it. Thus were the glory, Fravahar, and the material essence of Zarathustra in the two parents. After Zarathustra was conceived, the demons made dire attempts to cause Zarathustra's death in his mother's womb, and caused her to suffer from acutest and acutely painful diseases, so that she wished to consult the wizard physicians for a remedy of the ailment. And here was manifested a great miracle in which she heard a divine voice conveyed to her by the sacred beings which warned her to desist from consulting the wizard, for that would cause destruction, and advised her to perform the sacred ablution and bring dry fuel with her hands and for the sake of that infant to roast meat with cow's butter and make broth on the fire, and for his sake, i.e., for the sake of the infant, quaff it in time and she would be cured. Dugdab obeyed the divine instructions and was cured. Here the meat is not the ordinary mutton or meat of any other animal, but that of holy pasu referred to in Pallavi as Basariya. For 3 days before Zarathustra was actually born, the village became all lighted. At first people fled in confusion fearing that the whole village would be destroyed, because there were flames in every nook and corner, but afterwards they returned saying the village of Purushaspo will not at all be destroyed for in his house is born the glorious man-child. When the tidings of the birth of glorious Zarathustra spread in the world through the prophecy of Yuma, King Jamshed, and other illustrious souls, Yuma spoke to the demons that pure and holy Zarathustra would be born in the world and their destructive activities would be defeated. Ibid. In the golden age of the world King Yim, Jamshed, forewarns the demons of their destined defeat and overthrow at the birth of the glorious man-child. Professor Jackson. This term refers to the holy ceremony of Pasupashayan already explained under the head Technical Significance of Pasu in Part I. In Par there is reference to an ox in the reign of Kusa, King Kakas. Here the quadruped ox is not meant, but the animated kerp, invisible body, of the collective white side of the advanced souls of Bauryotika Esha class and other emancipated souls, who have entered Garudaman, the Satan-free part of the earthy globe, is designated allegorically as ox because ox represents the blissful live and let live principle in nature. The above advanced souls knew that the vehemence of the satanic force would be curbed after the advent of Zarathustra. In Par there is Pallavi reference to Torah i.e. Vigdat or Gaviadat, Avestija Shiva Dadiayo, which is rendered in philology as the primeval axe, is also not the quadruped ox, but represents the collective white side of the souls transferred to the space and the material world from the planetary world. This Gaviata tells Ahriman that he will not be successful in his destructive activities when Zarathustra takes birth on the material world. Before the birth of Zarathustra, Phrasayav, the sorcerer, thrice sought the glory of Zarathustra, Yasht, for which he supplicated to Artvisura, Yasht, for wresting the glory of Zarathustra and the fame, prosperity and good qualities of the people of Iran, with a view to crush them all. So he rushed to the six super-ethereal Keshvars, Yasht, and Zarivaurakasha, Yasna, and also to the holy terrestrial Keshvar Kinirath Bami, Yasht, situated in the Arctic region and buried under mountain-deep snow since over years. But since that glory was attainable only by the righteous and the great holy souls, Avan Artvisura did not grant him the boon. Here it may be noted that Zarivaurakasha and Caspian Sea have both identical meaning of wide short. But it must be remembered that the two have nothing in common except for their meaning wide short. Zarivaurakasha is the inconceivable huge and wide super ethereal expanse, allegorically called sea getting super ethereal waves, on the top of the space, while Caspian Sea on the north of Iran is only a wide material lake which can be easily measured. The next PAR contains the whole genealogy of Zarathustra which we have already given, partially abridged, in the beginning of this same chapter I. We shall now go to chapter 2 of the Dinkard. Sunjana Dinkard. Sunjana Dinkard chapter 2. Zarathustra laughed at birth. The marvel is recorded that Zarathustra laughed outright on being born. The tradition is recorded by Pliny, who observes in his Natural History Zoroaster was the only human being who ever laughed on the same day on which he was born. We hear too, that his brain pulsated so strongly that it repelled the hand when laid upon it, as presage of his wisdom. Professor Jackson. It is stated allegorically that seven nurses were frightened by his laughter at birth. Here the seven planetary heavens are depicted as seven nurses, DK7, CH2. In the case of ordinary worldly souls, these planetary heavens act as the veritable mills of God about which the poet sings, "The mills of God grind slowly, but they grind exceeding small, though with patience he stands waiting with exactness grinds he all." In this way, nature metes out condign punishments during life on earth according to the rule of Akamakai, Yasna, evil to evil, compatible with the soul's degree of sinfulness. In ordinary cases, a child at birth being in communion with nature, foresees the retributive punishments awaiting it in life through the planetary heavens, and hence it always cries. But the holy prophet's soul was Faraktam, most auspicious being sin-free, and was not subject to vicissitudes of life, for he took birth as a savior, and hence he laughed at his birth. Thus, so to say, the seven nurses, i.e., the planetary heavens were disappointed at his birth, because they would not be able to perform their office of visiting woe to Zarathustra. Bhaurushaspo called for soft woolen clothings for the child. In ordinary case, woolen clothing is intended to be for protection from cold. Here wool indicates two things, that it is taken from sheep, which possesses gava, i.e., blissful characteristic, and, it affords protection. Here protection refers to the protection by Dravasp, the protecting angel who is indicated by soft woolen clothings. Every child is under protection of Dravasp. Due to this, the pollution from the mother at the time of giving birth does not affect the child. Zarathustra was in direct connection with that angel, Dravasp. Both he, i.e., Zarathustra, and the angel were contemporaneous. This is referred to as soft woolen clothings, which stand for Dravasp. The mother Dughdob was exalted by her bearing within her the glorious child possessing divine connection with Dravasp. Biter bitten demon's hands turned backwards. When the demons did not succeed in causing the child Zarathustra's death in his mother's womb, and found that he laughed at his birth, they became very spiteful owing to the glory in Zarathustra. One archdemon named Durasrubo, who was much skilled in witchcraft, went to Bhaurushaspo's house to see the child with a murderous intent. He wished to crush with his hands the delicate head of that perfectly glorious child, and to cause his death. But immediately when Zarathustra's eye fell on the demon, his, demon's, hands were miraculously turned backwards towards the ends, that is, quite folded on the back, with the result that never afterwards could that demon devour meat by means of those hands. The demon saw the marks on Zarathustra's body, which he misrepresented to be evil, marks, which made Bhaurashaspa frightfully afraid of the decay of his son's luster, and so he hastened to hide him in some place beyond the sight of the sorcerers. The demon Dura's rubbo through witchcraft so cast into the mind of Bhaurashaspa the fear of Zarathustra, and so poisoned it that he even from the fear of himself solicited the demon for the death of Zarathustra, and the demon advised him to hide Zarathustra amid firewood and kindle it. But the miracle was that wood did not catch fire and the fond mother carried her son away. This fire does not refer to fire in the hearth, but within the body when a person is lamenting or pining through some vicissitudes or defeat or injustice or from jealousy, for it must be remembered that Bhaurashaspa was fully conscious of the invulnerability of Zarathustra's life and body by any power of sorcery. His seeming fear for himself and his solicitation to Dura's rubbo were only meant to befool that demon. The passage signifies that Zarathustra was not subject to such lamentations and burning in the heart. When the above witchcraft failed, next suggestion was to hide Zarathustra in a narrow path and to cause many oxen to pass on the path so that he might be trampled at night under the feet of the oxen. Then Zarathustra is said to have been placed near the opening of water pool and many horses caused to be run towards that water pool, so that he might be trampled under their hoofs. But a large horse with yellow ears walked before others did, and stood before Zarathustra, whereby he was saved. Here yellow ears indicate the development of Ray, divine self-intelligence in the horse. The fond mother rushed to her son and carried him away. Next he was placed in a wolf's den, in which the cubs were slaughtered, so that the wolf seeing her cubs slaughtered might devour Zarathustra in revenge. But the miracle was that when that wolf came to the den, it was much excited, but by the miracle of God, it knelt down so that its mouth was down on the cubs. Thus he was saved. In other words, the ferocity of the wolf was turned into docility due to the glory of the child Zarathustra. Then Sriyasha the holy and Brahman Amishaspend came to Zarathustra and brought to him a woolly sheep, to warm and feed him. The mother came up there, lifted her child, saying that she would not hereafter leave him under any circumstances. These animals were not the quadrupeds, but they indicate the degrees of exaltation of the potentialities of Bhaurashaspa, where they were either in excess or deficiency. Here the learned Dr. Chiniwala informs that these writings in the form of parables are not to be taken literally, but they designate the exaltation of those potentialities in Bhaurashaspa which were either in excess or in deficiency, in which degrees of exaltation are expressed in terms of bull, horse, wolf, and sheep. Then Dura's rubbo foretold to the demons of the coming of Brahman Amishaspend to Zarathustra, of the prophet's conference with Ahura Mazda, and of the propagation of the religion in the world. Bhaurashaspa is stated to be driving in a chariot and four horses. Here horse indicates power, and four horses means the power of the numeral four, which indicates the power of drawing or developing evil as well as good, so that the erstwhile evil can be transmuted into good. Bhaurashaspa was bringing home to Dura's rubbo, i.e., Turbaratur, the Satan, the superiority of good over evil, and the futility of his sorcery. He asked Dura's rubbo, "When you were brought before my son, why were you looking from him to the deepest depth and to the sublime height?" To this Dura's rubbo replied, "I was looking for a long time from him up on high to something sublime, then from him to the radiance and glory that he, Zarathustra, possessed together extending up to the sun, the radiance and glory that had no end." But Dura's rubbo did not understand why Zarathustra should have been endowed with such luster which connected him Zarathustra with the sixth heaven of Garo-Daman, Jupiter. The confusion of Dura's rubbo indicates the final success of good over evil. Dura's rubbo stated further that owing to the activity of this child, humanity will gain Tatnipasan, the final body which is fiery type and subtle. This gaining of the final body, Tainpasan, will mark the success of Asha, holiness over Druje, wickedness. It may be noted that when totality of souls will get Tainpasan in the distant future, fifth boundless time, it will mean extinction of Satan. The demons Durasruba and Bratrugrish were cognizant of the exalted position of Zarathustra and knew that the world will be enlivened and their activities would be curbed. However, they did not desist from continuing their evil activities. They wanted great catastrophes to visit Zarathustra and put their intent into practice, but they met with defeat at every attempt. So when Zarathustra became 7 years old, the two joined at the village of Baurushispa. They saw Zarathustra in that neighborhood when he was studying with other children, and they strove with evil intention to injure the mind of Zarathustra through witchcraft, and for that reason, fear and terror were cast by them upon the children, who were highly terrified, but Zarathustra did not care for it. Here the demons represent the dark side, and materialism in nature and growth of Zarathustra indicates the gradual progress of the white side. Baurushispa offered mare's milk to Durasruba to worship. Mare or horse indicates power. Here reference is to the development of power of advancing to higher path, milk, through repetitions of rebirths and condign sufferings during material lives. But those that are pure or holy have no need of such mare's milk, i.e., of going through rebirths and retributive punishments. The voice of the heart, which makes a person conscious of his transgression at each stage, is referred to allegorically as the food of mare's milk. On hearing the words of Baurushispa, which were addressed to Durasruba, Zarathustra promptly declined to follow his father's advice and said, "You should worship Ahura Mazda, who is worthy of human worship." This has created much misunderstanding against Baurushispa, and he has been erroneously charged with the worship of idolatry. The name of Baurushispa is referred to in Afrin Paiksumber Zartusht, Yasht, framed by the Renidar, resuscitator of the faith, as Poruaspem Bavahiyatha Poruchispem, i.e., may you be blessed with plenty of horses like Parushispo, which means plenty of spiritual power like Baurushaspo. This shows that Baurushispa was not idolatrous, as has been wrongly alleged. The name of Baurushispa has been taken in benediction in the above Avesta. Still, it is alleged that Baurushispa was idolatrous, and that he advised Zarathustra to do the same and that Zarathustra did not acquiesce. Such is the false allegation. This is inconsistent, because in the end Zarathustra says, "When anyone whatever shall join Baurushispa where he shall be performing, or celebrating, worship, the worship shall then be suitable to the worshipper, i.e., he shall worship him, Ahura Mazda, whom it is necessary to worship. In this worship, when through misdeeds a person has to undergo condign punishments, such suffering is called idolatry, because in such cases the misfortune of the sinner is brought on by the propensity of selfishness, etc., whereby that person, sinner, becomes oblivious to equitableness, and inclined to the worship of the archfiend." Durasruba threatened Zarathustra that he would take his life, but the miracle was that Durasruba, instead of succeeding in his threat, became disabled for as long a time as it takes to the milking of 10 mares, whose milker is only one person. From this he, demon, emerged again and tried to oppose Zarathustra, but got stupefied for double the period. But still he again rose and opposed Zarathustra for the third time, but was again defeated and stupefied for thrice the first period. Thus he gradually became disabled more and more and fled. This means that Zarathustra smote the demons, made them conscious of their evil propensity, turned their destructive, kraphastric, propensity into divine knowledge and wisdom, and thereby opened their spiritual eye. Here mare indicates spiritual power, milk shows blissful propensity, and numeral stands for perfection, here of blissfulness. When the sorcerer emerged from the dismay, he utilized his horse, i.e., the evil power, and exclaimed that if he did not call his evil power to his aid, Zarathustra would kill him by his mantras, holy spells, and by dint of his authority. But in the end both he and his evil power became vanquished and liable to destruction. In this paragraph, there is allegorical reference to the bursting of the semen from the demon's skin and breaking of the loins from his thighs, etc. Semen has reference to the demon's evil and selfish thought forces. But before the powers of holiness of Zarathustra, they were rendered futile. We know the function of the skin is to beautify the body, and at the same time, it is the medium for excretion of waste matter from it. Any impairment of the skin is the warning of coming trouble to the body. So if the skin is healthy, there is life and strength, and in the healthiness of the waist lies the sustenance of life. But when both the skin and the waist are broken, the human being collapses. Such dire consequences lead a soul to turn from vice to virtue. In this way the passage under reference shows the transmutation of evil plex uses into good. Zarathustra, besides possessing great wisdom and other spiritual powers from his birth, also possessed Ahayush. Aoj is the special divine power or potentiality possessed by Ahmashaspens and also by Zarathustra. Aoj occurs in the group Aojs or Nirog, Tejai in Pazand Afrani Ardafravish. Though ordinarily all these four terms convey the same meaning, namely, power, in Khshnoom, they have distinctive technical interpretations expounded under supplement number. Owing to his possessing the glory called Kian, Avestan Kavayam Karina, Yasht, which holy kings and warrior saints possessed, he had the characteristics of the four professions, viz., priesthood, warriorship, husbandry and fine artisanship. He displayed best friendliness towards the sacred beings and the good ones and an awful hostility towards the demons and the evil ones. Zarathustra was an angelic being, Yazati, among men. His friendship with God is embellished by his excellence of the sacred beings and by perfection through worthiness towards Ahura Mazda, so that the sacred beings, on account of his higher exaltedness than that of any one of those that exist, of those that have existed and of those that will exist, spread the good report of his advent throughout the world and of his salvation of the creations untroubled by the blemish giver, Aharman, through the manifold powers of the tongue of the sage, the perfectly virtuous of the age, doing no harm in the world. Here tongue of the sage refers to the holy formulae of Fshusho Mantra and Mantra Spenta employed by the prophet in spreading the faith. The demons even made friendship with the good people with the view that they would join them in confounding and defeating Zarathustra. They had made feverish attempts to thwart Zarathustra from his very emergence from the eighth heaven of the zodiac down to his advent on the earth, but they were foiled in their attempts at all stages. Zarathustra spent years in enlightened practices during which he drew vital energies from the eighth heaven of the zodiac. With the aid of these, he carried out great missions of establishing certain holy institutions in the ultra-physical regions above, for enabling fructification of great events during epoch-making ages, such as the revealing of other great religions of the world each at its propitious time, and for facilitating the success of the white blissful side in nature, he carried out great missions. When a person is on the righteous path and practices meditation with concentration with set postures of the body, and repeats or chants special holy incantations and formulae, his breath and ashtan, i.e., spiritually, vital energy do not remain commonplace. They become attuned with higher regions of the sky. Such holy breath is allegorically referred to as water from the river. Such breath then comes in contact with the plex uses between the brain and the heart in the proximity of the lungs, and affects every atom of the body through and through, so that it attracts angelic light, and his elements draw currents of blissfulness whereby thoughts become ennobled. Such practices which are of spiritually enlightened nature have been allegorically referred to as going to the river Ranghu or Danghu, and fetching water to the shore, in which water refers to the holy breath, as stated above. Bringing water to the shore also signifies founding great institutions in the skies and bringing them to their consummation. The above enlightened spiritual practice is of nine types, varying according as the person practicing be leading a pious life, or ordinarily worldly, besides other conditions. Thus one may be an ordinary person, whose mind is engaged in worldly thoughts, another also ordinary being but a priest who engages himself in religious ceremonies, a third, over and above these engagements, renders social service, a fourth besides rendering social service undergoes privations for others' sake on altruistic principles, and so on. From this it will be understood that the above mentioned spiritual practices are of varied types. In other words, the allegorical rivers Ranghu and Danghu have many effluents, the crossing of which entails severe or mild hardships, and the water fetched signifying the breath inhaled may be said to be muddy or pure, i.e., not so holy or sublime, according as the practitioner be an ordinary worldly person or a pious one. In these holy practices, when the thoughts are most pure and the breath and vital energy are highly exalted, they became attuned with the divine music of Ahunavar. All such practices belong to the last third group of nasks called Hatamantric, which deal with holy practices for the development of high spiritual powers. In later ages these practices came to be known as Sarvai Keshmar. The entire treasure of nasks comprises three groups dash, I, Gathic, 2, Datic, and 3, Hatamantric, the first dealing with Gathic hymns, the second with laws and the third with practices, exercises, and ceremonies relating to attainment of high spiritual powers. Zarathustra spent years in such exalted practices, during which he drew currents of holy vital energies from the eighth heaven of the zodiac. With the aid of the spiritual power developed by other practices, he fulfilled great missions for facilitating the success of the white side in nature and laying foundations for other faiths to appear in their respective epoch-making ages. During the current long cycle of time, Zarvain Dariga, comprising years, passing over four effluents of the river Daitya and bringing water to the shore refers to the founding of the Zoroastrian faith, under the influence of the central planet Jupiter, while crossing three effluents relates to founding non-Zoroastrian faiths which are under the influence of planets away from the central, Jupiter. In this, carrying water to the shore signifies the initiation and consummation of great prophetic missions. So when Zarathustra was performing the ceremony of drawing currents from the eighth heaven of the zodiac, allegorically referred to as Zarathustra coming up third effluent and walking upward, he saw Bhaman Amishaspend, as a model of angelic embodiment, i.e., he had a body without a parallel, an ideal of virtue and having a great height of three spears. He carried with him a shoot of the cypress tree which represented Mazdaism's new religion. The idea here represented is that as Vohumana was uninjured by carrying in the hand the symbol of the revelation, so everybody who would carry it, that is, would adhere to the religion, would be without injury in this world. Anyone who carried such a branch, i.e., practiced holy ceremonies, became immune from worldly sufferings or became exalted. It showed that it is the duty of every person to live peacefully without harming anyone in thought, word, or action. When Zarathustra was performing the ceremony of Hauma, Bhiman Amishaspend called Zarathustra. He asked Zarathustra for what he was undergoing the sublime trouble, which means the practice of drawing holy currents from the eighth heaven of the zodiac. To this Zarathustra replied that it was for gaining sanctity, i.e., for establishing truth. Thereupon Bhiman Amishaspend told Zarathustra to put off his garment, i.e., change the material body or elemental body into one of light because he, Zarathustra, possessed Asha, holiness. This is nicely expressed by Professor Jackson as under, Archangel, Vohuman opens his lips and begins to question the enrapt seer, and after bidding him to lay aside his garment, or the vesture of his material body, the seraphic messenger leads away his soul in ecstatic trance into the glorious and dazzling presence of Ahuramazda and the Amishaspends. No sooner does Zarathustra enter this radiant assembly than he ceases to behold his own shadow upon the ground on account of the great brilliancy of the archangels. Zoroaster, the Prophet of Ancient Iran, by Professor Jackson, pages. Here ends chapter 2 of Sunjana Dinkard, volume 13.